Okay, good evening everybody. That's to say, it's good evening for me over here. And enjoy your eating, whatever you're drinking or eating, while listening to my talk about Power BI and Access, about the troubled relation between the two. First of all, I'd like to say thank to Peter and Carl, of course, for their organizing these sessions. And I'm very glad to be able to say hello world. In this case, it's really hello world, because I understood that people from all over the world are actually joining this event. So that makes me very proud to be here. Very short info about myself. I hope this works. One moment. There we go. I'm a long-time Access developer, self-employed, so no job for me, but self-employed since 1986. Always worked with Access, Excel, SQL Server, Visual Studio, so I do a lot of .NET things as well. But as Power BI emerged, I really started using Power BI right away, because I was a big fan from the first day onwards. I think it's a really good tool for visualizing data, etc. So I hope I make share my enthusiasm for Power BI with you guys. I've been a speaker at Access conferences in Nuremberg and in Vienna as well, so I would have liked to be there at this moment. But I took my badge from last year from the conference. I hope you can see it. And I'm even entitled to visit the evening dinner tonight. So I'm okay.
Do some advertising in Tejan. Go on.
It was from the Access DevCon last year. So if you go there.
In Vienna.
Okay. And I have my Access shirt on. So, okay. I'm about to talk about Power BI and Access. First of all, of course, I'd like to start with a little demo of Power BI. But the main part of my session is about how to get Access data in the cloud, actually. Well, that's so. So I have a few sheets to start with. First of all, I should, of course, explain you a little bit about Power BI is. It's a visualization tool made by Microsoft. It actually started in Excel. But I think it was in 2014 or 2015 that they really made a separate program out of Power BI Desktop. You have a desktop version of the software, which is actually free, so it doesn't cost you anything at all to start using Power BI Desktop. And this Power BI Desktop tool is actually really the editing tool. So you can make reports and dashboards with it, in addition to database files in Excel or Access or whatever. But you can share, or you can connect it to a lot of data sources. I will show you afterwards. So you have the desktop tool, which is free. And then you have the online Power BI service, which is a website, which is a cloud-based website, which is actually meant for sharing the reports and for analyzing online. So a lot of people really enjoy going to this website and trying to get their own insights from the data, because those reports are very interactive. They are very interactive because you can click on everything, you can make your own slicing and dicing, etc. So this is really a tool that has a lot of fans now in the business world. A lot of banks, for instance, in my country have actually adopted Power BI at the moment and skipped Tableau, or they threw out ClickView or whatever other tool. So they start using Power BI as a tool for their business intelligence. The online version is not is not free. You have to pay or you have to pay $10 a month per user. That's a pro license. And then, of course, you can, as a big firm, a big company, you can actually pay some $5,000 to Microsoft. And then you have a premium license for Power BI, which enables you to share without any limit within your own company. You also get resources for yourself. So it's not a shared resource. It's a resource that's for your company only. So that's what Power BI exists of at this moment. It's a desktop version for editing, and an online site for viewing reports. So let's first of all start with the Power BI Desktop software. In this program, Access is a normal data source, just like Excel, just like Exchange, just like SQL Server or Oracle or whatever, but Access is a normal file-based database data source. The only thing you have to do is normally install the AceODB library. We've been talking about this earlier this day. And Abo said, well, this library might disappear in future, but at this moment you need this library to make Power BI connect to Access. One thing that's very important when if you want to work with Access and Power BI is that the version, the bitness of those two applications is the same, which means that a 32-bit version of Access can only be read with a 32-bit version of Power BI, and the same is true for the 64-bit version. So you can have both of them. You can even have both of them installed on your laptop if you'd like to. Yeah, but you need the separate programs to deal with the databases. This Power BI Desktop is actually a developer tool. It is really meant for people who know their way in Accesses or in databases in general. And they can even make all kinds of nice formulas in Power BI, and you use a special language for this. This is called DAX, the Data Analysis Expressions Language. And you have really MVPs and DAX already. So which means this is a formula language actually like it is in Excel, but it's for data analysis only. Power BI Desktop also includes a version of Power Query. I'll turn off my video. So this is also incorporated in the developer tool. So if you want to really use Power BI for free and for free only, then you could also give this Power BI Desktop software to your end users. And they could open your Power BI reports and they could enjoy those reports without paying something and without uploading something in the cloud. So this means it's really a free tool for making visualizations. Yeah. Okay. But that's, something we, perhaps you don't like this at all, but it's a possibility. Okay. Next slide. If you see this logo appear, this means there's a demo. What you actually see is a joke from a Dutch MVP. It's a Power Beer. T-shirts and coffee mugs, etc. You can buy it, but this is my indicator for a demo. So I'm quitting PowerPoint now and I'm going into Power BI. I will save it to my other screen. One moment, I have two screens open. Yes, there we go. This is Power BI, and this is the tool which we are going to use to make some nice visualizations. And first of all, I'm going to start with get data. I want to read Access data into Power BI. So in this case, I say, okay, I want an Access database. So I click on database and I see Access database right over there and I say connect. I'm going to use the Northwind database. We didn't see it today, I guess. So I'm going to use the Northwind database. So in here you see all the views and you see all the tables that are in this database. I'm going to select all those normal tables that are in there and I'm saying load. I could have said transform data, which meant that I would have ended up in the Power Query editor, which means that I had all kinds of possibilities of editing the data, adding columns, removing columns, filtering things, etc., etc. But I skipped this now at this moment. And I'm just loading the data into my Power BI Desktop file. And how do I see that this is it went okay? Well, you see it at the right side of the screen because you see all the tables from Power BI, from Access there. For instance, you have the customers there. If you open the customers tables, I could click country, for instance, and then I would see a map pop up. Well, almost. Well, there it is. So in this case, Power BI said, okay, this is a geographical file, a field. So I'll pick the map for showing the data. In this case, I'm going to go to my orders table and I'd like to say, okay, I put the order ID in the size. And in this case, I have managed to get the bubble as big as the number of orders in this country. If I use my mouse, I can just scroll into this map and I can see, okay, Germany is a big customer and Belgium is a little customer and the Netherlands, where I actually live. I live over there in Groningen, over there. There is nothing. Yes, okay. This is just one example of a graphical thing in Power BI. I could also join something. I could also put something else in there. I could also put in a date, for instance. I could say, okay, I want the date over here. And I could say I want the number of, or the average price per month, for instance, which is in order details, unit price over there. And then I have the average unit price per year. etc., etc., etc. I've prepared a little demo in which I have extended this example a little bit more. So I'm going to show you this file now at this moment, and I'm dragging it to the left so that I will be able to show you this one. Because I put in some extra effort in this example, which I'm going to show you now. In this case, I also put in some nice things, which are make Power BI such a nice tool to work with. I mean, it's very good at visualization, but it's also very good at calculating. For instance, over here, you see a nice graphical representation. And what I did in this case was I said I want to see the difference of the price in a certain month compared to the price in the previous month. Well, you could do something like this in Excel, for instance. But in my case, I used DAX for this. And I'm going to show you what this DAX looks like. I'm going to share this file with you, so you can always have a look at this file later on. But I'm going to show you what I did to make this possible. First of all...
A quick question. Is the data linked to the original tables, or has it been imported?
It is linked and it is imported. It said at the beginning, it said import. So the data were imported into these files, but there is an option over here and it says refresh, which means the data will be refreshed again.
Thank you.
Yeah. If you were to use a SQL Server database, you have the import modus, which is what I did here before. You load all the data into the report, but you also have the direct query modus in SQL Server, which means that you can just click on something and then the data will be fetched right on that moment. Yeah. But in this case, they are imported, and that's why you have the need to refresh. Yeah. Okay. I was about to show you the DAX that I used for this nice visual over here. What you need for this is you need the value of this month, you need the value of last month, and then you need to deduct the two of them. And how do you do this? Well, I have a DAX formula over here, which is called average. That's the measure name I use. I could have used any other name, but you see some DAX over there. It just says, okay, give me the average of the unit price from the table order details. Yeah. So that's very nice. That this is just like Excel almost. But now I have a very nice extra formula. That's this one. This formula is a little bit more complicated. I hope you can see it. I can zoom in a bit as well. It here says, okay, please calculate the average, but I don't want the average for the current month. I want the average for the previous month. And how does Power BI know that what's the previous month? Well, I will show you. Because in any Power BI model that you would use, you would normally insert a date table, a date dimension table. And I inserted one over here. And this actually, this DAX over here, this what you see over here, that's DAX. And this thing makes a date dimension starting on the 1st of January 1990, and it ends at the last day of 2000. And it will give me all kinds of data on this calendar. So if I click it and I will show you what's in there, you will see that you will have the date and you will have the month number and you will have the year month number, you will have the day of the week, etc., etc. If you have such a table in which there is not one date missing, you can have all kinds of very intelligent time intelligence things like previous month, previous year, same period last year, etc., etc. So that makes Power BI really an impressive thing to work with. And that's why I think Power BI should be well known to actually all Access developers. But of course, that's my personal opinion. Okay, I have my report ready now. I can now say publish. You see publish right up there at the top of the screen. If I publish this, I first of all have to save this file, of course. And it will ask me now in which workspace at my Power BI service account should this thing be published. Well, I say put it in my workspace. Well, there we go. I'm now publishing the report to the service. this lasts a few minutes. No, not a few minutes, a few seconds. We just have to wait. Yes, here we go. And if I now click it, I will see the same report online. It's appearing on my other screen, so I'll get my screen to the left. So you'll now see the report I just produced in Power BI Desktop, and it's now online. And even online, I have all kinds of possible things to do with it. I could, for instance, change the date that I'm looking at. This is all online. I could click on a certain bubble in Northern America, and it would just show me down there the changes. So if I click somewhere, you see all the other visuals react to this, because actually every visual is also a kind of a filter. Yeah. So in this case, I've put a report online. And now the problem starts, because this report is based on Access. No, nothing wrong with Access, of course, but you'd like to have some kind of synchronization between data. I mean, we were talking about gateways, et cetera, et cetera, before. And that's why I'm going to talk about this a little bit longer, because you see what Power BI is able to do. You see what the end effect might be. But we'll have to talk about how to get your data online on a regular basis. And that's what we're going to talk about later. But I'm first of all returning to my sheets, to my Power BI, and I'm going to restart my sheet. I just showed you this one. I'm going to talk about the Power BI service a little while before we go on demoing this thing any further. So you have a central web address for this, powerbi.microsoft.com. That's the address. I mean, if you were to go there, you could also download Power BI. So if you're interested in Power BI, this is the address to go to. You download the software over there. Or even better, you don't go to the site to download it, but you go to the Windows Store on your computer, because if you install Power BI Desktop from the store, from the Windows Store, you will always get the most recent version of the software. It will be updated automatically, actually, which is not true if you download the software yourself. Then you have to do it yourself. And actually, Power BI is in an update cycle of 1 month. So every month there will be new updates coming to Power BI. And actually, you have a 3/4 hour YouTube film every month about all the updates that are there in a new version of Power BI. Yeah. So the Power BI website is used for sharing the reports with other people. I mean, you can make groups of users. You can have your Active Directory groups of your company, for instance, to assign a certain report to. Yeah. On this site, you have the possibility to create workspaces, which is for developers only. And from these developers' workspaces, you publish apps. And those apps, they are for end users. And those end users, they can use this report online, of course. They can go to this website. Or they could also install an extra app on their iPhone or Android telephone or on their iPod phone or on Windows 10 devices or whatever. Because then they would have the business intelligence right in their pockets. I mean, this app on this iPhone is connected to this web service. So you can really enjoy all those reporting things on your app, on your telephone. Yeah. Well, I did a little bit of demo already on this, but I have a second demo on this case, because it's also possible to incorporate this website thing in Access. So I'm going to open another Access database now. I'm going to draw it to the left. Here we are. What I did is I have an Access database over here, and I have a form over here. And if I click the Power BI anonymous form, I will see in Access a shared Power BI desktop report right in Access. I just used the web browser control to enter this. Yeah. And if I just look at the thing that I programmed, well, I didn't program anything for this. I just said, okay, give me the web control. And I just pasted this address in. I got this address from the web service. I mean, I can show you afterwards where I found it. But this is an anonymous link, so to speak. So if I were to send you this this thing by email, you would all be able to click it and to view my report. So this is not protected by a password or whatever. This is anonymous. So it is public, actually. So that's why I also have a second form in which I did log in. So I hope it will, yes, in this case, you see that I've logged in into the website, but it's all within Access. So within Access, I can click those pages as if I were in the browser. Well, of course, it's the browser control, that's so it's true that I'm in the browser. But if you like this very much, you could also use this to program it, because a report online can be filtered through the URL, through the address in the address bar of your browser. So in this case, for instance, I could say, okay, I want to see the report of a certain postal code. And I say, okay, show the sales per postal code. And then it will open this particular postal code. Yeah. So you can use VBA to change the report in Access. Okay. So far about the integration of Access itself, the report in Access. But we wanted to talk about data, so that's why I'm going to return to my Power BI, PowerPoint presentation, because we have to talk about the way you bring your Access data to the cloud. I mean, we've seen Alexandru talk about the CDS, for instance, and showing that the data of Access could be incorporated in there. But I personally don't think that is a solution that many of us would like. I would prefer plan A and putting the data from your Access database in a SQL Server on Azure. And that would be the nicest way to go forward, because then you could use your Access front end to work with your data, and you could also connect a Power BI report to this same SQL Server. Yeah. And for those who don't know how to do this, you have a SQL Server migration assistant, which would actually do the dirty work for you and bring the data over to the SQL Server. I must admit, of course, that the Azure interface is not very, very friendly. So it might be the case that some people of you are frightened to go over there, which I can understand. But I guess if you take some YouTube films, you would be able to fix this in no time. Yes, but I'm not going to show you this, because this is something that's, well, perhaps known to some of you already. If you put the things online like this, you have a refresh possibility of 8 times per day, which means that 8 times per day you can schedule a refresh of the Power BI model online. Carl asked about how the data were imported into the report. Well, it can be automated. It can be automated 8 times per day if you have the pro license, and if you, it can be updated 48 times per day if you have your premium license of Power BI. Yeah, but of course a user can also click the refresh button himself on the website, and then the data will be refreshed as well. Okay, well, one print screen of how the Azure portal looks, and you just see the SQL database over there. So you just create a SQL Server over there. You use the SQL Server migration assistant to bring the data over there, and then the rest is history, I would say. But as we already said, for many people, it might be one step too far going to the SQL Server database. So we have some plan B, C, D, E as well. So we have the manual possibility, of course. We have the Excel export, the SharePoint, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm going to tell something about them in a practical way. First of all, of course, you have the way which is very cheap. You open the Power BI desktop file on your system. You press the refresh button and you say publish again. So if you would find somebody in your company who wants to do this every day, things would be ready. Yeah, but of course, the most of us are developers, so this would not be a developer way of doing things, I guess. A second way would be to export your data to Excel, which we all hate as well, probably, but okay, it's a possibility. So you could make Access export things to Excel. If you were to put those Excel sheets in a OneDrive or in a SharePoint document library, then you could use Power BI to connect to this online file. Yes, so it's a data source as well. You have the data source Excel locally on your system, but you also have the data source Excel on a web address. So you just don't make the choice for Excel, you make the choice for web. And you paste in the address of the Excel file, which is online. To make this easy, you can also install the OneDrive updating app, the syncing app, which means that you could save the files on your local file system, and you let this app synchronize the data between your laptop and the Power BI, the OneDrive on the SharePoint site. So this means exporting and syncing, and then the rest is history again, because then the files are online. And then you have this 84 refreshes per day option as well. It's also true that if you update the Excel file, the Power BI report in the service will be updated as well. Yeah. So this is a possibility that some people might like. You just export Excel things. Yeah. Here's an overview of what this looks like in Power BI Desktop. The left side, the left visual is about the Power BI Desktop, and you just see over there that I have a connection to an Excel sheet in the cloud. I just blocked, of course, the domain name, but this is a SharePoint file. And yes, I was busy with Corona as well. So this is about a Corona Power BI dashboard. Yes, but it's SharePoint. So at the left side, you see the Power BI Desktop connected to an Excel sheet in the cloud. And on the right side, you see what's possible in the Power BI website, because in the Power BI website, it discovered that this report was connected to a OneDrive file. So it says, okay, if you don't do anything at all, I will update this file for you even hourly. Yeah, so you can schedule them anyway yourself, but it will be updated hourly as well. So actually there wouldn't be any need for a refresh yourself, but the Excel sheet would be updated every hour. So that would be very practical as well. Having said this, this would be more a developer kind of thing to do, I guess, to move your data to SharePoint. I mean, the previous presenter also showed us the use of SharePoint in this case, and I'd like to talk about this as well, because it's a very practical thing to do. I mean, it's less complex than SQL Server, and if your database is not too big, SharePoint is a thing that you could take very serious, actually. I mean, most of you know probably what SharePoint is, and actually most of you will probably have SharePoint already, because you have an Office 365 account. So you have SharePoint coming with this every month for free. Well, almost for free. You pay for the Office and then you get SharePoint for free. The SharePoint list is the way to go. A SharePoint list is actually a table. So you can make a table. You can make it online or you can make it in Access and then upgrade it. But it's a table. It's like a table in Access. So you can have all kinds of fields to it. You can have all kinds of field types in it. The length is about 30 million at the max. I just tried as a demo for this case that I inserted 200,000 items, which it all survived. But it's a theoretical, this number of items, because it will be very, very slow. Yeah. So your database shouldn't be too big to move it to use it as a backend for Access. But of course, you can also do this. You could also say, okay, I only export the things I want to report on. You could make an extra view with the things to report on, say, for instance, only containing the data of the last 6 months, and then put this in a SharePoint list for reporting use only. Yeah, but that's up to you. Use SharePoint as a backend, or just upload the reporting items. But so as soon as they are in SharePoint, well, okay, the rest is open, because you can use Access as a front-end to the SharePoint list, but you also have, of course, a SharePoint interface. You could go to the website and enter your data, or you could update your data, or you could make all kinds of nice things online with it. But you connect it to Power BI as well, to Power Apps, to Flow, etc., etc. So you get a lot of things as an extra, so to speak, if you were to go to SharePoint. And as I said, it is already a part of your subscription, so most of you have it. I'd like to show you how this looks like. First of all, I will show you in real life afterwards in a demo. But first of all, you have an impression here. At the left, you see the SharePoint list. at the right, you see how Access deals with this list. It's the same data. So if I were to click at the right side, it will be updated on the left and vice versa. And at the bottom of the screen, you'll see a proof that I just actually entered 274,000 items in one list, and it all survived it. So only Access got a little bit slow, sluggish, would I say. Okay, I'm going to demo this, I guess, afterwards. You have two possibilities for moving your data to the SharePoint list. You could start in SharePoint. You make a site over there, you make a list over there, you add all the fields you like over there, and then connect this list to Access. That would be one way of doing it. Another way would be the other way around. You start in Access and you say, you click on a table and you say, I want to export this to a SharePoint list, which means that the SharePoint list will be created for you online. And then, of course, you can connect this list to Access again. Yeah. Right. If it's in a SharePoint list, you could go to Power BI and then just connect to Power BI. You see at the left side how I connected the Power BI report with this site online. So I entered the address of the site in Power BI. And then afterwards, it shows me all the lists and all the things with the rows and columns in this SharePoint site. So at the right, you see orders, for instance. Yeah, and customers. So those two are Access tables that I upgraded to this SharePoint list. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to show you. So I'm going to close my PowerPoint and I'm going to open a SharePoint file, which is this one. And I'm going to wait a minute. That's the wrong one. This is the good right one. So here we go. This is Access. Well, you know it, of course. I have two tables already connected. You see here the customers table. You see here the orders table. But I want to add one more. So, for instance, I would want to upgrade the products or the orders details table. I click the orders details and I say export, export to SharePoint list. Well, of course, I prepared this. So in this case, I did this before. So in this case, it's already known to access which site I might want to upload this. But this is the address of my site that I created on my tenant on Power, SharePoint. So I just say, okay, and it will now create the list online and publish all the data online. So this is going to last a little bit, but you can believe me, this is now on the way. So I'm going to start my PowerPoint again, because you know this is the next step, what I'm showing you here. I mean, if the list is online, you can just connect it to Power BI. Yeah, and you also can connect it to Access again. I will return to Access afterwards to see if it's ready already, then I can connect it again. But I'll give it some time to upload. I'm going to jump to the next way of connecting your Access database to the cloud. And Alexandru already talked about this gateway, so I'm not going to talk about this too long. But Microsoft has a gateway, which is software which you install on your laptop or on your server. And this gateway connects an online data source with a local data source. And you actually have two modes. You have, an enterprise mode, a multi-user mode, and a personal mode. Yes, so it has two gateways. And you have an on-premise and a personal one. At the bottom of the screen, you see a little film, YouTube hyperlink indicating how to use this kind of thing. But it means you install something. So I don't know if you like this kind of an idea, but on your on-premise laptop, you install something which enables Microsoft to enter into your system or to access your SQL Server or to access your file system, to open an Access file, to open an Excel file, to open whatever file there is on your system. Yeah, so that's the gateway trick. So I'm not going to talk about it too much. It's about it's just a few more sheets here. I mean, you can see at the left side what is the gateway on the internet. So this is the kind of database or data source that a connector can connect to. So you have a gateway for SharePoint Online, for Oracle, on-premise, for Oracle on-premise, for folders, for files on-premise, for OData on-premise, MySQL on-premise, etc. So you have all kinds of data sources that the gateway could connect to. And at the right side of the screen, you see the Power BI web service where this gateway is also existent at this moment. But Tovan already showed this, so I'm going to move to the next sheet. Because there is one more way of doing this, which means that we also have the possibility to access this data set directly as a programmer. Yeah, so we could use the API or the web API for this. But before I do this, I'm curious about access or if it already updated the file. So I'm going to skip Power BI, PowerPoint, and I see access now, and it says, okay, the file has been uploaded. So this means this file is online now. So if I were to go to this site and I would go to site contents and I would go to site settings, then I would see this list over here. Where is it? It says, yes, there it is. The customers are there, the orders are there, and I uploaded the order details, as you remember. So if I click it now, here they are. Here are the, well, one moment. This is just the structure of the file. You want to see the content, of course, which is over here, order details. Here are the records. And what I do now, I just take this address, which is at the top of the screen. I take this address, this SharePoint team site address. I go back to Access because I want to incorporate this. I want to open the other file in Access, which is this one over here. I uploaded all the details and I'm now going to connect it. I say, okay, I want a new data source. It's a data source from an online service. It's a data source from SharePoint. It's from this address. You still remembered it. And I want to link the data to Access. Which table do I want to link? In this case, I want to link the order details because the other ones I had already linked them. And I say, okay. And now, you see order details one, because I already had order details and I have order details one now as well. So I'm going to rename this one as old and I'm going to rename this one as this. And now all the forms and all the queries and all the reports I have in the Access database will just function as if nothing happened. Yeah. So then I finish this SharePoint Access integration thing. And I'm going to return to my sheets because I was about to talk about the API. If you upload a data source to the Power BI website, this data source will turn into an API. So this means that a programmer could actually connect to this API with any programming language you like. Yeah, it could be VBA, it could be VB, it could be C#, whatever. You could also connect to it with Power Automate or whatever, or so even with Power Apps or whatever. Yeah. So I'm going to show you how this works, and I'm going to show you this with a streaming dataset example. First of all, I'm going to show you this. Of course, I'm going to show you in real life as well, but I'm having some sheets over here indicating what I'm going to show you afterwards. This is a print screen of the Power BI website. And I have a data set over there, which is called machine streaming. And if you would click the three dots, it would just indicate that it's an API. And therefore you have this API info. If I go to the next page, you see at the left side of the screen that this API machine streaming has a certain web address, which is this very nice address over there with the push URL. And at the bottom of this page, you see what kind of an input this API expect. I mean, it's a very simple thing in this case. I just made an example with just a machine name and an integer field with the output. But if there's 20 columns, of course, this JSON would be a little bit more complex. But at the left side, you see the technical things of this API. And at the right side of the screen, you see the visuals. You see those green bars Carl, Peter, Jeff, etc. This is a Power BI visual, which is based on this Power BI data set. And at the right side of the screen, you see VBA. And of course, I'm going to show you in real life, but you can imagine what is going to happen. I use VBA and I push data into the streaming data set. And then the Power BI service will update this visual. Yeah. So I'm going to show you now. I'm going to quit with PowerPoint. And I'm going to open my Excel file again. One moment, which is over here. Yeah. And I open my module in which this code is to be found. I'm first of all going to show you what this thing does, and then I'm going to try and explain what this does. I'm going back to the Power BI web service. I'm going back to my workspaces. I'm going back to my machines. I'm going back to my machines dashboard. And here you see a dashboard, and at the left side of the screen you see nothing, because there are no data in this thing at this moment. But if I'm now moving back to Access again, to this data I had just opened over here, just see what's happened. I mean, who is the first one who wants something? Carl is of course the one that has the right at the first entry. I say F5 now. There's Carl. I say Peter. Hey, Peter. I don't know how to spell Peter, but Peter has 12, etc., etc. So you see in this case that I am able to use VBA to push data into a streaming data set on Power BI Web Service. And what did I do in this access thing? Well, it's very simple in itself. I mean, I create an object for web requests, and I put in the address of this API, which I copied from the website. Nothing more and nothing less. So I make a web request. I have a certain URL, which means that I want to have data sets to be filled. I open this connection, and I then create a payload. In this case, this just means I just create the JSON here that I need to fill this data set. So that's why you see machine name and output, and I put those variables at the back. Yeah, so if I were to run this code like this with F8, you would see that I have very nice payload thing, which is over there. The machine name is Jeff, the output is 12. And I say, okay. And if I return to the website now, I would say Jeff is there as well at this moment. So I hope it's clear to you now that you could use a programming language to fill those data sets. So you could use actually a VBA routine to push data into a streaming data set. In this case, it's a streaming data set. The other data sets are normal data sets. Well, normal, I will explain you what normal means. It's the not streaming. So if I upload this Excel file, it would make a normal data set. But if you were to push data into that one, that would be a little bit more complex, because this is only allowed for applications that are registered in the Azure Active Directory. So that's a bit of a hassle. So there might be something in between, which makes it a little bit more practical, and that would be Flow. This is the last thing I'm not going to show you, but I'm going to tell you about. There is Power Automate, also known as Flow. And Power Automate and Flow also have the possibility to push data into Power BI. So you, at the left, you see two examples of possible flows that you could make. You could say, okay, I want to push data to Power BI if there's a new file on SharePoint. Or the other one is very interesting as well. I want to push data somewhere if there's a new item created on SQL Server. And at the right side of the screen, you see how this kind of a flow would look like. In this case, it says, okay, I take a certain time. So the recurrence means, for instance, I would do something every hour. I would then get the rows of the SQL Server. And for every row that I would fetch, I would add those rows to this data set online. So that would be the last thing I would want to tell you about Power BI and Access, because you could use this flow from Access. I mean, just as I put data in a data set from VBA, I can also call Flow or Power Automate things from VBA. So that was what I wanted to tell you about this kind of things. If there are people who want to know more about it, please contact me or put a message in the team things. I'm always willing to help you, of course. And now I'm curious if there are questions.
I think most questions have already been answered in the chat, but you can turn on your mic and just ask. We have some minutes left.
I have a question. In the presentation where you showed Power BI inside of Access, does that require a license, a paid?
The top one, the first one I showed doesn't require a license. That's the public one. The second one requires a license because I logged in. That's why I showed you both of them. But you also always have a way of publicly sharing. I will show you. There's always a possibility of sharing a report. I go to reports, this one, for instance. At the top, there's almost this possibility, embed. You see, there's this public to web, publish to web. That's a public one. If I click this one, I'll get, well, oh, not in this example. Okay, I need another example. But it's, I hope that this one is possible. There is this possibility of publishing it. Okay, sorry. I don't know why this is not working at this moment. Because this would be the possibility to share it with everybody, actually. To incorporate it, no, it's not possible at this moment. I don't know what happened or what changed, but you get an URL from it. I mean, in my Access thing, I showed you this URL, so I got it there. So probably I could use it again. I could go to my workspace. Because that was the sales... Retails, yeah, this was a retail analysis example, I guess. Yeah, there we go. Right. So at the top, you see this address. This over here. So this URL, you could I just pasted it in the web control. So you don't need a license for this. And the second one, you lose your license because I logged in. But if you use the public way of sharing, of course, this is a risk. I mean, if somebody gets this address and puts it in the mail, well, everybody can access it. I heard about people that got mails with public reports from Tesla.
May I come in, please?
Yeah.
If you try and use the free version of Power BI with Office 365, and Access, you get an error message saying that Access 2010 is required for the free version of Power BI, but you do not need SharePoint.
You don't need SharePoint. No, not at all. That's true.
You can create an Excel spreadsheet, which feeds directly from an Access database and use it. And as has been said a number of times, if you create a lovely, fancy Power BI graph using Excel or whatever, you can save the report file as a Power BX file. And if any other colleague in the organization has access to both the data and the PowerPoint and the Power BI report file, then they can bring up the data on their screen. It's their live data to which they have access, and the wonderful graph that you have created. You don't need the expensive version of Power BI. Thank you.
Yeah, you mean you don't need the version, the online version, the Power BI thing?
You need the free version, the desktop version will do fine.
Yes, okay, that's the first option I said, and you don't have to go to the online version. You can, within a company, it's okay if you use the free version, but of course you can't share the reports with other people.
Yes, you can, please, if they have access to both the data and the Power BI report.
Yeah, you can share the PBX file, which is just
Yeah, okay. In this case, yeah, okay. Of course, you can just open all. Everybody can open the same file. If that's what you mean with sharing, yes, of course you can share them. Yes, everybody opens the same file. Yeah.
But if you make the shared file read only, then they can't change any sensitive data, and they can go wherever they want and show those lovely graphs.
Yeah. Yeah. Perhaps I should add. I should add to this that Power BI itself is not able to change data at all. So that's just, I didn't mention this before. It's a read-only thing, so to speak. It's a one-way direction.
Yeah. Okay. One other question about what Power BI can and can't do. Can Power BI export data as if, you know, just like from Access, you can export data?
Yes, if I were to, yes. If you see it, look at the screen at this moment, you have every visual, you have the possibility to export data, which means that you get the data that are in this visual. So that is one way of exporting. You can just say, okay, I want data that are under this visual. I say export data, and it will ask you what kind of a file would you want to see. So that's one way of doing it. A second way of looking at the data is you go to the data sets, and then you have the option of explore with Excel.
Okay.
I hear an echo. It's...
That's my unit. I'll go back on mute. Sorry.
Okay. But if you go to a data set, there is the possibility to share with Excel, analyze with Excel. So those are the two ways of getting your data from the report again. Yeah. Other questions?
I think we're done for today. Thank you very much, Intian. Very interesting. You got a lot of applause in the chat.
I didn't read the chat. I'm going to start and read the chat now.
Good job.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.